Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a little weak, but that's okay. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church and our 10 o'clock worship service. If you would, please tear off the top of your bulletin with your name and stuff so that we know that you are here today, and drop those in the offering plate. I do have a couple of announcements. One is that tomorrow night's unity service for Clarksville has been canceled because of the weather. The second one is Planning Day, which will be this coming Saturday from 9 to noon. Session will meet in the afternoon, but this is a great time to join a committee. So if you're curious about what our committees are, please talk to Monica or someone in the office and they can let you know and you can pick out something that you would enjoy doing. Also, our speaker for today, he told me he wasn't preaching, so I couldn't say preacher, but Mark Ray, our new music director, will be our speaker for today. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please stand and join me in the call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for God is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Those who exalt themselves will be humbled.
And those who are humble will be exalted.
Let us worship God. A new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. I will cause you to walk according to my ways, so you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Friends, believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
With the Lord.
prophet is somebody that tells us what God wants us to know. He kind of talks through God, or God talks through him. So Isaiah tells us that Jesus is going to be just an ordinary man, nothing special. Nobody's going to know how important he is. So when Isaiah tells us that he's going to be an ordinary man, that means people won't think he's anything special. They won't know to act any way different. So what happens is he's mistreated like ordinary people are. Sometimes people don't, they're not very nice to Jesus when he's growing up. So he reminds us that God sends Jesus as a servant, not as a king. So what that says to me is sometimes we only treat the best people the best way. The ones that have a lot of money, or the ones that are really pretty, or the ones that are really important. But Jesus wasn't any of those things. He looked like an ordinary man. He wasn't rich at all. And he didn't have an important job. He wasn't an emperor. He wasn't a king. So therefore, a lot of people did not treat Jesus very nicely. But you know, he was the best. He was the Son of God. What did we know? So we're going to talk about children's church for now for the next few weeks about how Jesus grew up, what he did, how he was an ordinary man, how he was one of us. And then we're going to also talk about the miracles that he did and the people that he touched. So Isaiah was a very smart man. He told us a lot a long time before Jesus got here. So now that Jesus has been born, we're going to talk about how he grew up, what he did, and how he helped us to be the people that we are. So let's stand together and say a prayer, and then we'll go back to Jesus' church. God, help me to listen and to learn about you and your son, Jesus, and all the good things that he did while he lived here on earth. Amen.
Child will be called the prophet of the Most High,
For you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. I'm used to being over here and waving my arms and stuff, so doing this is somewhat a little bit unfamiliar, but we will get through this together. I want to thank you all for a really gracious welcome here, speaking with the folks from this church throughout the fall and then in coming now. I've been doing this for a long time, and you don't often find a family of really sincere, committed, dedicated, steadfast Christians who gather in a church for no other reason but because of their faith. This is because of your love for God and your love for each other, and that is so clear, and it is an honor and a pleasure to get to serve with you here. I will note that upon hiring me, my old friend Pastor Greg immediately fled the country. Not going to dwell on that, but I will point out, in moving books out of my old office, I actually found my 7th grade yearbook, and we're both in it. That's job security, is what that is. One thing to know when working with me, and as a choir hopefully already knows, I see humor as a gift from God. I take my calling and my faith and my work very seriously, but I don't take myself very seriously. An anecdote may erupt at any moment, so just be prepared for that. Was asked to share a little bit of background. I actually have known Pastor Rick since we were both in middle school. We were great friends then. His family had moved. We wound up being roommates in college. We didn't even know that we were both going to the same college, let alone being roommates. We're moving in as a Greg, Mark, really? So since then, and having had the privilege of knowing him and Beth in college and then in grad school close together, they were in New Jersey, I'm up in Connecticut, back and forth since then, and our lives went different directions in our callings, and I can't help but think that it was a God thing to bring us together again in Middle Tennessee. So what a pleasure and an honor that it is to work with Greg. Grew up in Union City, Tennessee, way up in the northwest corner of the state. They got twice as much snow and ice as here, so Mom is still kind of digging out over there. Went to Union in Jackson, where Greg and I were in college together, graduate degrees from Yale, and then I taught for a while at Notre Dame. Choral music was a director of choral activities there, did a lot of performing there. I was at First Presbyterian Church in Libertyville, it's a big suburb of Chicago, for a good while, and then spent a lot of years in Minnesota. I was in Rochester and also up in Fargo, Moorhead. For 15 years. So this morning, I decided to put on a long sleeve shirt, so I think it was okay with that. There were some formative things musically for me that helped to shape who I was, how I see music intersecting my life, our lives, and therefore, since I think that church and life are not separate things, we are all bound in this together. This is just another part of when we gather and then we go and live this out during the week. I think these things all do come together. I was very fortunate when I was 16 years old. Got to be part of a group at the time called America's Youth in Concert. If you were in your all-state choir, band, or orchestra, you could audition to be in this in the State Department. Essentially, you're up for a month. Great honor to get to do this. But being exposed to cultures that I had not known, to places, to how these things can impact you, to get to sing in Notre Dame in Paris on Bastille Day when you're 16, shapes who you are and makes you want to go back, which about 15 years later I got to do as a conductor. So these formative experiences help to shape how we see our relationship with the arts, and particularly as a musician, and how that impacts us and how we live. That was also the first time I got to go to Italy to connect with my roots. I am mostly Italian and would love to speak to any of you about anything related to that. Going back there, when I was at Notre Dame, I had my men's choir on tour in Europe. Many of you know Mont Saint-Michel in France, this beautiful, it's an abbey in the village perched on a giant rock off the coast of Normandy. It's a big tidal plain around it. It could never be besieged in the Middle Ages because the tide comes in for almost a mile right there. And when it comes in faster than a galloping horse. So they were safe, and this place had been secure for a very long time. It is a mystical place. I think that some places can hold a spiritual meaning for us, that we don't have to be in those places to experience God, but there are places that enable us to experience God in some pretty profound ways. We were the first American choir to ever get to sing for the High Mass at the Abbey Church, way up at the top of Mont Saint-Michel. And as serious and beautiful as this is, the thing I remember most, I'm standing here, I'm conducting the men, and they're singing, and this little monk comes out. If you've seen Monty Python or anything, you know the little monk guy that comes out. Okay? He looked kind of like Tim Conway in the Little Man character, if you remember him. He comes out, and you know, the hood and all of this. We have 72 men singing on either side of him. He's kind of fascinated by this. He starts to pull the bell rope. You know, the bell's up in the tower, the rope comes down. He's pulling the rope, and eventually the bell gets going. It's one of these big things, has some travel time. He's so fascinated with the music, he forgets to let go. And the next thing I see is this monk. He's somewhere between 90 and 200 years old from the Americans, okay? He forgot to let go of the rope, and he's going up and down, being pulled by this bell, and the poor guy's terrified. So I keep conducting, I motion a couple of basses, they go over and rescue the guy from this. But no, there were spiritual memories from there, but most of it was about on the rope. Having gotten to make music in all these places, it was borne in on me that what is appropriate in one place and time is not appropriate in another place and time. I've worked in a number of churches, different denominations and traditions, different places. I believe that different styles of music are appropriate in worship, and that they're chosen by their appropriateness. We don't hear or use that word much anymore. To me, appropriateness includes many things. It's not just music. You dress differently for a date than you do to worship the creator of the universe. Easter morning, a dress and hat is different than the jeans that you're going to wear to go to barbecue. The music has to be appropriate for the occasion, I think, as well. And I think we have a variety within the bounds of appropriateness. I shared a story with the search committee here when we met. I had that same men's choir. We were on tour in Puerto Rico. Yes, we sang with the Philharmonic in San Juan, Mozart concert, whatnot. That was great. But then we went out and we got to work in the barrios. And we volunteered for community service projects. And we sang a mass outside in a barrio just west of San Juan. And I will never forget this. We go out, and it's this giant slab of concrete and some posts and a rusting, corrugated metal flat roof over it. It's open to the outside. It's this huge slab of concrete. And that's all it is. And there's one little gravel road going up to it where we took our bands. We go and we prepare to sing, and the priest is there. There's a table for an altar, and there's a little group of instrumentalists. They played some instruments that I recognized, but some had been homemade or native to the culture that I didn't recognize. One of them was kind of like a banjo, but the instead of a case, it had an armadillo. I'm serious. But this was indigenous. This is what's important there. And is in one of the poorest places in the Western Hemisphere. Most of us cannot imagine the poverty that these people endured. And they started to arrive on foot, in the cars. And he would come out of the forest, the jungle, the hills around us, walking in, and they were immaculate. The one good garment that they have, they put on because we're going to church. It's not to show off, it's because this was important. This was the one good thing a week that happened to the 1,500 people get under this metal roof. And we sang, and the band plays song, and then the priest consecrates the host, where in their theology that Jesus is physically present in this bread. And he lifts this and breaks it, and the band starts to play. And 1,500 of the poorest people you've ever seen get up and dance. It was David in front of the ark. The one good thing that happened in their week was when Jesus came, right there. And they celebrated it through dancing. I'm not going to ask you to do that. But for them to see the faith, the joy, that was what was absolutely appropriate there. So we determine together what's appropriate here, what speaks to us, what is our voice, our language as a community. I love jazz, particularly I love jazz. I love spirituals, the slave songs. Some of the jazz and spirituals are not the only indigenous music to our American culture. The songs of hope. God has spoken to me so many times through music, often in church, often not. I don't have to have words for God to speak. God is beyond our words, I think. But sometimes God speaks to us through words. We're different from each other. We're at different places in our lives. So the music in church is going to impact you differently than it does you, than you, on any particular Sunday. By having what we together consider appropriate variety within our family, we hope to connect with as many people as possible each week. Sometimes music is a way to communicate with God both directions. It's not just us singing to God, but we can receive through that as well. My old friend Doug Berkey is an actor, and he makes these amazing masks, both to be used in theater to show character and also just frankly as museum pieces are gorgeous. And he delves into character in that way. Doug has all these talents we all wish we had, but none of us do. Doug tells a story about how one time after a performance he needed to do, you know how when you're a little kid and you want to do something for your parent to show off how good you are at something? Doug has told the story one time that he was backstage after a performance and he needed to pray and do that to God. So he got on a unicycle and juggled while he was doing it to pray. It's like, hey, Dad, look at me. It wasn't for anybody else. It was to establish a relation with a father. There are times when epiphany comes upon us in a new way. It's got to be at the right time and in the right place. A piece of music at a different time means something different to you. If you know the Christian allegory known as the Hobbit, the dwarves have to open a hidden door that can only be seen at exactly the right time and in exactly the right light. And our job is to try to find the right time and the right light to open God to us through music. Alice Parker, who is a fabulous American composer, conductor, arranger, she said to me once over lunch, she said, very matter-of-factly, as if she's having a salad. And in the middle of this, says, well, you know, music is the language of paradise. All words are sung in heaven. And it goes back to her salad. Like, wait a minute. Say that again. She said, music is the language of paradise. All words are sung in heaven. So on my napkin, I'm taking notes from all of this. And I hope that that's as Luther said, when you sing your prayer, you have prayed twice. I do think that sometimes a piece of music can be truly divinely inspired, where a composer just happened to be the scribe writing it down. You probably know some of those who speak to you in that way. It's things that, to me, pierce the veil between heaven and earth. The Eclogue of Gerald Finzi, the Guitar Concerto of Rodrigo, Rocky II, Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto. Everything Bach ever wrote. The Barber Adagio for strings. We all remember 9/11. You probably remember the Sunday after at the cathedral back in Fargo, trying to figure out what on earth are we going to do today for music. And we insert at a place in service that normally didn't have music. I played the Barber Adagio for strings on the cathedral organ. And that was what broke the walls down. You have terrified people who can't make sense out of this coming in, holding it in. And they broke down. And the weeping that was cathartic that happened during that started the healing process for us. Always remember doing that. One of my favorite composers, Frank Martin, who was a Swiss musician of the early to middle 20th century, he wrote this mass in the 1920s. He said, "I've never had it published. It's just a matter between God and me." This was an exercise for him. And he kept it for 50 years and didn't let it be performed. Just before his death, he allowed it to be performed. I wrote my dissertation on that, and I got to conduct a performance of it in grad school. Of the people who were there, there was a seminarian. His name was Heidi Pryor. Heidi was at Yale Divinity School. She was pursuing her MDiv. She was on an ordination track. Brilliant and compassionate and wonderful. And she came to me after that concert and she said, "You know, I never really believed in the resurrection until now. Because what Martin wrote convinced me." That's what I hope we can do. Has God spoken to you through music? It's one of the last things we remember. Often in the church, we deal with folks toward the end of their life with dementia. It's tragic. It can be heartbreaking. But it's also a time to reveal some things that are planted really deeply. I can't tell you how many times I've been around people who could not remember their own name, but could sing a hymn with you. Because those words, linked to music, are planted deeply. What words do you want to remember at the end? What words do you want planted the deepest? Here's some I want. Our first hymn today, "Praise to the Lord the Almighty." The line in that, "Have you not seen how all you have needed has been granted in what God ordains?" Love divine, all love is excelling. Be thou my vision. The King of love, my shepherd, is the church's one foundation. All six verses, his every word counts. O sacred head, what language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest? If thou but suffer God to guide thee. You ever seen the movie Babette's Feast? I want to come back sometime and talk about God and the table. It's the most amazing film I've ever seen and speaks profoundly for artists and people who want to know what it is to serve God. What words do you want planted in your heart? Sing them. What we do here is important because it plants these words deep in our hearts. It pierces the veil between heaven and earth if we allow it to. The Dean of American Preachers, great African-American preacher, Gardner Taylor. He died a couple of years ago, Easter Sunday, 2015, at the age of 96. His words helped me many times through some of the darkest days of my life, and he inspired many of the brightest ones. I once heard him say, he was preaching in New Jersey, once heard him say that our goal our quest, our striving as Christians, must be to become so much like Jesus that if we're walking down the street next to him, angels who are looking out from heaven will become confused and will say to each other, "Which one is Jesus?" I'm nowhere near it. Many of you are closer than I am. But our journey is to take that direction. And I'm glad that we're heading that way together.